We're going to go to our first review, Willoughbys. So this is a movie that came out on Netflix. I think, did it come out last week or has it been out for a while? I can't remember.
Last week, I think.
So it did for me. I didn't know, but I didn't see any trailers or anything like that. I just saw people say, review Willoughbys. I'm like, what the crap is that? And then I was like, okay, people want us to review it, we'll review it. That's just my rule. Now, not a person who's watched any trailers. I don't know if this thing is based on a book. I have absolutely no
idea.
Yes,
let me jump in for a second. It is based on a book. And I, at the end of this movie, saw who the author was, and I freaked out because I love this author. And you guys know her. You guys know who she is because we read all these books in school. Lois Lowry. She's the author of The Giver.
Oh, okay.
And that was a terrible movie. It was a terrible movie. Fantastic book. One of my favorite books of all time is The Giver. And she wrote Number the Stars.
What's that?
Do you guys remember reading Number the Stars in school? We read it in fifth grade. It's about a girl who's a Jewish girl. And the Nazis are chasing. It's a lot like Jojo Rabbit. Like, there's a little girl who's Jewish that they're hiding in their home.
Wow.
And they're a family trying to hide this Jewish girl in the home, pretending to be a sister. It's fantastic. It's a really good book. So Lois Lowry, fantastic author. She's written lots and lots of kids' books. I love her books. Huh. I had not read The Willoughbys, but when I saw the cover, it did look vaguely familiar. So I did go back and listen on YouTube to the first three chapters of the audiobook. And it's not my favorite of her books, but it's a weird, quirky book. And I'm kind of wondering if I had read it as a kid, it probably would have hit different for me.
Huh.
There's a quote from Lois Lowry that I'll never forget because they told us this in fifth grade. Lois Lowry says, with adults, you have the first five chapters to get the adults hooked. With the kids, you have the first page. If they don't get hooked on the first page, they're not going to read the book. So the very first two pages of this book are the kids finding the baby on their porch. The movie drags that out and makes it about 20, 30 minutes in before they even mention the parents or anything in the book. They're already finding the baby. So it jumps right into the action, and they actually kind of slowed it down and brought the action a little bit slower into the movie.
Okay.
But it's a weird movie, but I'm going to let you guys jump back in.
Yeah, I was going to say, let's not discuss too much about the movie and save that for spoilers. I don't actually know what spoilers
are. That's not a spoiler. That's all happens in the first 10 minutes.
Oh, okay. So I'm going to be very vague because if I've never seen the trailers, most people who are going to watch this movie probably are not going to see the trailers. So this is just my feelings on what I think were like without giving anything away.
Through the glass, over the hedge, follow the rainbow to
quiet!
Where my dreams begin.
Shusher, shusher!
I will be free.
All the Willoughby children ever wanted was to have a normal family. But their loving parents had no love left over for them.
Hi, Mommy.
They are creepy.
Barnaby, will you stop?
Our parents are the worst. Just think about how great our family could be if they were gone.
How do you propose we discard of two insidious grown-ups?
Easy.
No!
No, not there. There.
So that's why the Willoughby children,
we shall craft a dangerous adventure,
are sending their parents on a trip to die for.
Ghastly!
Ruthless!
What does it say?
See the world.
And you know what else? No children allowed!
The best way I can explain this is I could not stand the first 10, 20 minutes of this movie. It was annoying. It was stupid. I wanted to kill that cat.
The parents, cat was my favorite character.
The parents are so annoying, and I'm not feeling anything for the kids.
Yeah.
And it's so bad. Like, if we weren't doing a review and I was just watching this movie with my wife or with friends or by myself, I probably would have changed the channel 5, 10 minutes in. I'm like, this is not a movie for me. In fact, I don't like Tim Burton movies because of this one reason and reason alone, if that helps without giving the movie away. It's just weird. and like, it's just the kids are weird and the story is weird and the animation is weird and nothing about it is appealing. In fact, the first 20 minutes is probably enough for me to just say this movie's terrible. But I did keep watching. And without giving any spoilers away, there's a nanny that comes into the picture and the movie got interesting.
Oh, hello!
Ranger, Ranger!
I am your nanny! I cook, clean, sing!
What? You sing?
Yeah!
Family services?
We've received reports of children without parents.
Kids, we have to go. As long as they think you don't have a family, they'll keep chasing you.
We have to stay together.
We're gonna find a new family.
Yeah, nice.
They were really good after that. And I was kind of invested after that point. And so the middle is really good, if that makes any sense. But the ending is terrible and the beginning is terrible. Is the best way I can explain it. Without going into spoilers, the middle is great. It's actually good. The beginning, I would just, I don't know who worked on this movie, but how do you mess up the beginning and ending? Like, I just don't understand. It's the only movie I've seen where the beginning and ending is terrible, but the majority of the middle stuff is actually pretty decent. So I don't know who this movie is for. If you like kooky, weird movies, like, and I don't, so I'm being straight up with you. I hate Tim Burton. I hate Tim Burton. Hate's a strong word.
Did Tim Burton actually work on this, or were you just comparing
comparing it to him because...
I can see that, definitely.
Another movie. I don't like Lemony Snicket's. I can't even stand the TV show. I can get through two episodes without wanting to punch every single person on the screen.
The Lemony Snicket books are amazing.
I believe you. I just don't like the TV show. But I like the movie. I enjoyed the movie with Jim Carrey, but I hated the TV show. And I really wanted to like it because I like Barney from How I Met Your Mother. So I was really invested. And I lasted two episodes and I was like, okay, I'm good. I'm done. I'm just, please take that away from me. I'm just not, it's the type of weird, kooky, weird movie style that I am just not a fan of. And Shannon, you're going last because you're going to talk for like 10, 20 minutes straight. So I'm not going to you next. I'm going to George next so he can share his thoughts.
All right. So yeah, this was interesting. This movie, let me just say that, yes, I agree with Fahad that the beginning and ending were absolutely terrible. The middle was actually pretty good. But I...
No way, are you serious?
I'm serious. I am serious about that. That is...
When you were watching the movie.
I felt it, man. I felt it. So, with something that I was like, okay, this is kind of all right, but like, the animation, I'm not sure why exactly they did it sort of like staggered frames that kind of like, I don't know, it just irked me. But I know they tried to almost do like a like the clay model animation style with 3D animation, but it was just annoying. I hate to say it, but so yeah, the beginning I really couldn't stand their feelings with their parents. I couldn't justify because their own feelings seemed pretty messed up. So that being said, man, I really liked, honestly, I'd have to say about 3/4 of the way into it. If they just ended it right there, I would have been perfectly fine with it. It would have been great. But yeah, they had to go and keep going on this movie. Something I had an issue with was the way they did auto-tune. I'm sorry, but every time that little girl sang, there was so much auto-tune in it. I'm like, okay, this is way above what they even need for the auto-tune. I mean, like, she didn't need that much auto-tune. I'm sorry, it just sounded terrible because of it.
I watched a behind the scenes thing, and the girl who did the voice of Jane did her singing, and her name's Alicia Caro, and this is her very first movie ever, and they like gifted it to her because she went on a talk show and said she'd always wanted to be in a movie as a voice actress. She can't sing.
Actually, Alicia Caro is a pop artist. So I'm not sure who the little girl was. I'm not sure who the little girl was, but
that
Alicia Caro.
That
was the one song I could handle. Alicia Cara's voice was the one song I could handle. She sings it in the credits without the auto tune. And oh my gosh, it sounds so much better.
Well,
so
she did the voice of Jane, so I don't know why.
Is that the girl?
It.
Is that the little girl?
Yeah, the little girl.
She was kept singing about the rainbows and stuff. Okay.
Yeah, I wasn't a fan.
The weird thing about that is every time she tried singing, somebody would cut her off and she would never sing. And I'm like,
yeah, she never finished decision? Her song.
It's like, you're setting up for someone to sing a song, and you're like, okay, this is that moment. And then somebody just comes and just stops it. And I'm just like so confused by it.
I hate to say it, but I relate to that so much because every time I do, someone always stops me. So anyways, that part was actually a little bit comical, but it was only comical to people who try to sing all the time. So it is kind of a thing. I really, really, really had issues with all the rest of the soundtrack except for like the credits song, which I had actually heard that song before because I'd heard it on iTunes beforehand because, you know, like they tend to release the soundtrack first. And so like I had heard that song on iTunes. I actually kind of like it, you know, I mean, like it really sounds pretty nice. I heard the auto-tune version and I'm just like, ugh. It just irked me terribly. But without going into spoilers, Shannon, what are your thoughts?
I have to do this without going into spoilers. It's going to be a little hard. Okay, I agree with you guys that the middle was definitely the best part. I did like the beginning. I did not like the end. I really liked the cat, who's the narrator in here. That's not a spoiler. That's the first thing you see in the movie. And I thought that the characters were very one-dimensional. I did not like that. I thought that they missed out on a lot of heart and emotion that they could have injected into this movie because they didn't take the time to build three-dimensional characters. In the books, and I've only read three chapters of the book, I already know so much more about these kids and their lives that I feel like they're well-rounded people because I've read three chapters of this book, which is like 30 or 40 chapters long. But I watched a 2-hour movie and I did not feel anything for these kids. So other than Jane, who had a little bit more character, I think that they missed a huge opportunity here. I think they were on to something, but the animation was not cute. I didn't like looking at these characters other than Jane. I thought Jane was well animated. Didn't like looking at the nanny. I didn't like looking at the parents. Jane's the little girl.
Why is she better? I don't know.
I just thought her character design was pleasant to look at.
Oh,
the
really?
Two ugly little twins with their stupid mushroom heads. I couldn't stand looking at that. Like, nobody has hair like that. It was annoying. The parents were just too one-dimensional. So I had, when they went at the end of the movie, I'm not going to say it, but I didn't feel for the decisions that the kids made towards the end of the movie because I didn't feel for the parents. There's just a lot of really undeveloped characters and bad character design. The candy shop owner, I thought, was a terrible design. He didn't feel like I don't know what he was supposed to be. I don't know why he was in the movie. He didn't have any real backstory behind him, where in the book, they build him up as a real character, and you understand like why the kids interact with him the way that they do. I really am excited to finish this book because I think it's going to be so much better than the movie, and I can't say much more than that without going into spoilers.
Yeah, I think you guys covered it pretty well. I think our feelings is it could have been better without going into spoilers. And that's about... I'll give the movie credit where it's due. Okay, so without going into spoilers, the candy shop factory guy and the candy, rainbow candy and all the things with that was cool. I did like when they were trying to sell the house and some of the pranks they were doing. That was pretty good. I enjoyed that a lot.
That was fun.
But again, that's the middle with the stuff that's actually good.
Wait, can I just say, the reason that I got hooked into this movie in the first 5 minutes is the house. The house design is so cool. I wanted to live in this house. It's like this old Gothic Victorian mansion with all these secret passageways and stuff. Like, there's a movie called Clue from 1985 that's just a haunted house with a bunch of passageways.
Classic. That's one of the best movies ever made.
I love Clue. I don't even know what happens in the plot. I just watched that movie on mute just to be in the house because I think the house is so cool.
Wait, you didn't actually watch the movie with volume?
I have 3 times. I don't know what happens in the plot. I don't care. I just want to talk. I just like some of the jokes, and I think the house is cool. The house is so cool. And that's how I felt in the first 10 minutes of this movie. Like, they did a really cool job with the set design. I thought, like, I want to live here. I want to be in this universe. So that's part of why I love this movie. It's just because that's my time period and my aesthetic.
Sorry, the dog came and now I'm not listening. My bad. George, what's the dog's name? He's
This guy's name is Raj. Raj? Yeah, he's...
Like from Aladdin?
Well, it translates into king in Hindi. Oh. So, yeah. So, basically, yeah. Same thing.
But, yeah, Sultan, he's,
he is definitely a bundle of joy.
So, I, just to go back to, sorry, I got distracted, Shannon. I hated the house. I thought it was ugly.
What? It was
orange. And orange is, like, one of the worst colors. And everything is orange and it's nasty.
I didn't even notice the house being orange. I didn't even notice that it was orange. I just thought it was
the house,
so
I tuned
gothic
out.
And Victorian, and it was so cool.
Yeah, I like that. Like Knives Out
right now. Or,
you know, Knives Out, the house.
Yeah, Knives Out's a great example.
But this house was ugly. The house of Knives Out is great. I just thought the house was so ugly. I was like,
I disagree. I thought it was beautiful.
Shut it, blow it up, sell it. And then they stole the stupid idea from Up, where it's like between like this giant city and the small house. I was like, come on.
Well, that's actually in the book, though, which was written years before Up.
So she stole it from Up. Whatever.
The book was written like 20 years before Up.
Whatever.
That's a common thing. You see that in movies.
Whatever. Okay. The middle is okay because they're not in the house and they're actually doing something. I want to talk about the ending because I think it's hilarious.
Let's jump into spoilers.
Yeah. So final score, if you like Tim Burton, if you like Lemony Snickets, if you like weird movies that I guess this is for you. For everyone else, just skip it. That's my score. George, what do you got for us? What's your score?
I would say listen to the one song that matters. And I honestly, for the most part, would say to skip this movie, which is a rare one for me because I normally like the majority of kids' movies. But this one, there were some, I don't know. It was like I really had no feelings for any of the characters. I mean, like any of them, no matter what they did, it was very rough. I really couldn't stand this movie very much. But yeah, there were a couple funny things in the middle, but I mean, like, I'm not sure if it was worth watching the rest of it for. I'm going to be honest. Shannon, what's your thoughts?
I'm giving it a 6 out of 10. Now, I'm a good target audience. I love Lois Lowry. I love Lemony Snicket. And I like Tim Burton. And I love old houses. And I like kids stuff. So, like, I'm right in their target market. But I think they missed a lot of stuff. They missed putting the characters well-rounded. They missed having a heart to the story. They missed driving home the moral at the end. I think I'm only going to give it a 6 out of 10. If you read the book and you want to know how they adapted it, then I would watch this. Otherwise, eh.
Yeah, I was going to say that all the things that you mentioned, plus I would also add that I do think the book would be better than this movie, because somebody said they included two books into one, and they did that with Lemony Snicket's too, but I enjoyed it. I like the Jim Carrey movie, as weird as that sounds, and everything that happens in that movie. I just think it's funny that Jim Carrey plays like 5-6 different characters trying to get those kids back. But again, I've never read the book and I can't stand the TV show, so I don't know.
I literally have the books displayed right here.
Oh God, don't do that with the camera. I'm going to throw up. It was that, way too fast.
That's a Lemony Snicket poster and all the Lemony Snicket books right there. All right, I'm going to move the camera again. Don't throw up.
But I was going to say,
a Lemony Snicket poster in my house, guys, displayed in my kitchen.
Where, Shannon, where are you going?
Wait, I'm showing you.
No more showing. Please don't move the camera. I believe you. Yes. Yes. I believe you about Lemony Snicket. Okay. So, you muted yourself.
I was going to say, Lemony Snicket wrote an amazing series of books. Don't judge it by the movies.
No, I like the movie. I don't like the TV show. You missed that part. I like
Don't
the
judge
Carrey
it by movie. Anything other than reading the books.
But I like the movie. I'm judging it on something
that
was
good. I'm talking
good.
To our Geekdom movie audience.
Oh, okay. Well, this movie was not for me, and the parts that were good that had everything outside of the house was great. I thought them trying to figure out if the nanny is good or evil is one of the funniest things in the entire movie.
Yeah.
Where the boys, they're like, the soup, it's like, you gotta try this. And they're like, and then, like, he won't eat it. What's his name, Tim or something? I forgot the boy.
It's Tim, Jane, Barnaby A, and Barnaby B.
And I did like the twins. You said you don't like the design. I thought they were hilarious. And they're like, oh, we like that. I like that. I like that too.
I like how they shared one sweater and they're like, shh,
yeah. And I love Tim's little thing about growing a mustache. And he's like, can I touch your mustache? The candy.
Oh, yeah.
That was so funny.
And I liked how the cat narrator was like, these are the twins. They're creepy. Next.
I don't like Ricky Gervais. I think Ricky Gervais is the most annoying person on earth.
What? I'm sorry. He it's created The Office. He can do no wrong. He created The Office. He can do no wrong.
And that's when
Ricky
Gervais was nice. And now he's just a jerk. He attacks people in Hollywood. He attacks like people who have religious beliefs, and he talks about atheism is the way to true in life. And if you're religious, he just goes way too far with that. And I can't.
Yeah, that's true.
I can't stand his voice. And I don't even care if you're atheist. It just everything about him just irks me, and I don't like the way the person he's become today. He attacks Steve Carell at the Golden Globes, and Steve Carell.
Oh, he did.
And, like, Steve Carell almost stopped, he, like, stopped talking to him for 2 years. They had a huge fight. Because Ricky Gervais went up and said, like, Steve Carell, you're not that great. You stole my character. You owe me for your fame. You're not that special. He said that. You can find it on
I think it was a joke. That sounds like a joke.
It's a joke that went way too far, and Steve Carell took it personally. And so many people this year, like, did you hear Tom Hanks and Tim Allen basically bash him? Because, like, his jokes always go too far. I mean, it's hilarious.
Well, he does not fall in line with Hollywood. He's not afraid to say what he thinks. And he doesn't
he's Trump
he's
on the
he's,
left.
We're not going to bring Trump into this. He's not politically correct. I definitely goes too far sometimes. But because he's not falling in line and worshiping Hollywood, a lot of people
not that. He's just
anyway,
a-hole left or
as
right.
A voice actor, he did a great job as the cat in this movie. I didn't realize who it was until the end, but I think I just like British accents, and I thought the design of the cat was really good and how it worked into the story. The cat, I don't believe, is the narrator of the story. They just have a cat in the book.
I'm so confused, but okay, sure, yeah. And I can't stand the ending. I really hated the ending so freaking much. It almost...
Why?
And the movie, the beginning was bad enough with the house and the kids and the weirdness. But it got better, and it was fine. And I was like, you know what? I'm probably going to end up giving this a positive review. And then the ending happened. And George, you texted it. You said, like, parents should not be, like, parents, like, moms don't want kids to watch this movie. To be fair, they kind of have a point,
Shannon.
But they... you
texted
that, didn't you?
I follow a lot of mom groups on Facebook for other reasons. And this movie, a lot of moms who did not watch it or have not read the book saw the trailer and were like, I will never let my child read this book or watch this movie because it includes killing the parents. And I was like, first of all, the parents don't die. Secondly, you haven't even watched this movie, so you should not be commenting on the moral of the story when you don't know what the moral is because you haven't read the book and you haven't watched the movie. And it pisses me off when people ban their children from something they don't know anything about and they don't understand. That makes me so angry. So these moms were all attacking this movie, and then a couple of the parents and myself who had actually seen it went in and they said, the moral of the story is not that you should kill your parents. These parents are horrible, abusive parents that don't even feed their children, that don't even, in the book, they're actually a lot nicer. In the movie, they made them into just one-dimensional stick figure, like horrible, evil parents. So the kids send them away because they want to become like all the orphans in the storybooks. They want to be like Anne of Green Gables and Pollyanna and Harry Potter, and all the famous literary children are orphans. And so this is a book that is playing on those tropes. Lois Lowry's a very clever author, and she's written a lot of books, and she's read a lot of books. And she's writing a book here that plays on the tropes and subverts them and turns them upside down. So usually in movies, the kids are already orphans, and that's where the story begins. But these kids have a house, and they have parents, but they have terrible parents. So they decide, what if we just made ourselves orphans? And they don't actually kill their parents, but they do send them on a long trip just to get away, you know, get the parents away from us, and then we'll tell everybody that we're orphans. So the moral is not to kill your parents. It's a book that's playing on tropes and playing and subverting expectations. And the book is fun. The book does it in a clever way. The movie, I think they kind of missed the ball, but if you're not going to let your kid watch this because it includes lines about killing parents, you're completely missing the point.
Well, all that to say, I disagreed with everything you just said, Shannon, but I'm glad it worked.
Of course you did.
I don't like Lemony Snicket's. I don't like anything about those characters.
What does it have to do with Lemony Snicket's?
Because this movie reminds me of Lemony Snicket's and Tim Burton, and I don't like those type of stories. That's why I was going to say the ending does not work in any level, whether it's book or not. I don't care. That ending of just having parents that's starving their kids and then they deserve to die, which they do because they are horrible parents in the movie. I can't judge it on the book. I didn't read the book. I'm never going to read the book. But on the movie basis, I would agree those parents are terrible. And I think those kids are stupid to try to rescue them and take them back. I'm like, wow, you guys are making good decisions. Then you made the stupidest decision in the world. Let's go back to our abuser. Like, what kind of a message is this?
I did not like the way this ended. I think that they should have lived with the nanny and started their own family and then showed what happened to the parents. Because that's something we've never seen before in a kid's movie is, what if the parents are abusive? What are you supposed to do? How do you handle that?
And they did end up eventually. They did finally just let them blow themselves
up. Let them go,
But again, it took too long to get to the point. And by the time we got to that point, I was already like, I'm tapped out. I don't give a crap. I'm good. I don't need a resolution. I really could care less.
They also did not spend enough time building up the candy shop owner character because you kind of forget that he's even there.
He's the best character besides the nanny in the entire movie. Everyone else is annoying in my opinion. But him and the nanny were the best characters.
The nanny was pretty great.
And I think the orphanage was the best part in this. They look like Matrix, like Men in Black
people. Oh yeah, the orphan services.
Oh my gosh, that was so well done. It's so sad that there are so many good moments in this movie that get ruined.
I know,
by just bad execution.
It has so much going for it. It could have been a really good movie. It needed like 3 or 4 more rewrites, and it needed a different animator. If they had made these characters pleasant to look at. Instead of weird and off-putting.
And that's the weird thing, because last year Netflix made the best animated movie. I don't think any animated movie. Oh my God, that movie was freaking phenomenal. And talk about Tim Burton stuff. That movie has it, but it does it in a way where you can ignore it and just appreciate the story. Klaus was 10 out of 10, one of the greatest animated movies about Christmas I have ever seen. It set up a new mythology for Santa Claus that has never been done before, and it does it so well that I'm shocked how good that movie is. And then to go from that to this movie, it's like a night and day difference. It's like Netflix, what happened? You guys did such a good movie with Klaus just like a few months back. What is this? So for me, like, I would say, spoilers aside, this movie is just not that good. It has good moments, good parts, but it's a terrible film. George, you gotta jump in here and tell us to shut up already.
I was waiting for a break in it. All right, so yeah. Wait, are you guys there? The screen's frozen. Okay, never
mind. Sorry, I've been on mute. Can you hear us?
Oh, yeah, you're good. So with this, okay, let me get into different points I like, didn't like. Well, I would have to say that I did like I really liked the nanny. The nanny was awesome. The nanny was there to support the kids. She did a phenomenal job. The guy with the candy shop, he reminded me a lot of Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, and for obvious reasons. I don't know.
Without creepy Johnny Depp, Michael Jackson
exactly.
Weirdness.
He seemed more like an adult who was like, who had the ability to raise a kid. So, so then there were the parents. The parents, my take on them, I don't know. I don't know what my thought was really on them, because they, it seemed like they changed their character mid-movie. They didn't seem like the same people going into, like, when I first saw them in the movie.
That's a good observation. I didn't even.
They weren't the same characters as they
were
at the end of the movie.
Because they were annoyed. Yeah, like they were annoyed at the children, but they still let the children stay. Sure, they kind of didn't feed them well enough, but they were allowed to be in the house and live there. And then the second half is such a weird jump in their character. You're right.
They changed so much. It was like they
were
very
drastically.
Like at the end of it, it's like they were completely in love with each other. But like to them, the children didn't even exist, and I don't know how to take that, because I can't handle when a movie just like completely splits a character like that and has them completely different between beginning and end. They're adults, for goodness sakes. They won't change that much.
Makes so much more sense. I'm like, something's bugging me about those parents. And you just actually kind of nailed it.
Traits.
That's exactly what that was. They went from accepting them as their kids, yet being annoyed at them, but they still let them stay in the house. And they weren't evil. They were just horrible parents.
Yeah.
Just bad parents. And then, the second half of the movie, they're just evil. just want to let the kids get, I don't know. They just completely shifted.
Also, one of the, this is going to sound really strange, but one of the main issues I had with the reason why the kids wanted to get rid of the parents was because the boy actually, he thought this had to do with the mustache.
Okay.
I'm sorry, but that is a terrible reason to try to get rid of your parents. I mean, that's absolutely terrible.
The better reason is they let us starve to death, and they don't let us be, maybe if we can just get rid of them, we can be in charge. It would have made more sense than mustache, right?
It's like he used that as his main point, and that bothered me a bit. So there, I'm trying to think of other things here. There were a few other things, the way they ended it. Granted, I don't know if this was trying to follow the book or something, but the way they did that, where basically they found the parents, they thawed the parents out, and then the parents just completely oblivious to them go and steal their dirigible and get out of there. I don't know. I can't handle that. There were certain things in that they could have done so much. Like the way the kids the way the kids left the nanny and the candy man, they went and left him like they left them at a point where literally they were all about ready to go and find the parents. But these kids decide, no, we don't want adult supervision. We're just going to go and leave and do this on our own.
Yeah,
and
it's, I don't like, know what was up with that.
Yeah, that made no sense. They finally found some responsible adults, and then they go and ditch them and wait for these adults to come and save them. And it's like, oh my goodness.
Yeah, like they went to find their parents in the snow, and then they ditch them to go to find their parents up on a mountain. So much drastic weirdness. Anyways, we're about to run out of time here, but I think we got the gist of, I mean, like Shannon shared a lot, I shared a lot. I think we can all agree. I definitely, Shannon liked it more than me and George, but it's a strange movie, and this is not something I would recommend. And that's, we're just going to leave it off that. So our next review is Sinbad, Legend of the Seven Seas. This is from DreamWorks. We previously did a review for Prince of Egypt. Other movies are Prince of Egypt, and Road to El Dorado. I have never seen Sinbad, but it was recommended to me. And it stars Brad Pitt as Sinbad and Catherine Zeta-Jones as the love interest. Guys, I've never even heard of this movie. I never saw any trailers for this movie. I might love this movie, if not more than Prince of Egypt. And I thought El Dorado was good. But to me, this movie was exactly the type of movie, the adventure, like Pirates of the Caribbean, Treasure Planet, Treasure Island, just that type of world and storytelling. I don't think Hollywood does enough with that. With those movies and that genre, and I'm so happy to see this movie even exist.
No wave is too huge. No enemy is too powerful. For the most daring thief on the seven seas.
Sinbad!
Yeah.
But the greatest challenge he'll ever face...
We are going to die!
...is the newest member of his crew.
A ship is no place for a woman.
Five on Marina.
Oh, no!
They've got a goddess on their tails.
This is going to be fun.
Danger at every turn.
Let's go!
And a whole shipload of adventure.
Give that guy a raise.
Still think a ship's no place for a woman?
I think I'm gonna be sick.
From DreamWorks Pictures. Brad Pitt, Catherine Zeta-Jones, and Michelle Pfeiffer.
Who's bad?
Sinbad.
Captain, it's the edge of the world!
Pay up, it's flat.
It exists in a way where it's actually really good. At the same time, I loved everything about Michelle Pfeiffer's, like, this goddess character who's, like, manipulating, like, Sinbad, but then Sinbad is manipulating her back, and there's this back and forth, and there's this whole thing with him and the girl, and like, oh my god, this movie's animation is out of this world. It looks better here than it did in Sinbad and El Dorado. I was really blown away with some of the scenes. That scene of this giant owl and the snow, and like, you know, where you go to the end of the world, because like pirates and people who used to go on boats and stuff used to believe the world wasn't round. And just like that scene, and then like, oh my god, there's so much about this movie. And I love the guy who's just like flipping around, turning on candles throughout the ships, and he's just kind of like Spider-Manning it up. I don't know, man. Like, this movie was so well made. The story was so great. I was so invested, and the script is smart. Like, these people look like they're real people with real banter, if that makes any sense. All three movies have had great writing. Like, and Prince of Egypt definitely has the best music out of the three, but this movie to me has the most adventure feel, the most like epicness at the same time. God, like at the end of this movie, I actually was like, can we have a sequel to this movie? Because like Sinbad has like 10, 20 books out there, man. Like there's so many stories to tell. Why are we not telling them? This movie's a 10 out of 10, golden popcorn. Go see it. If you loved Princess of Egypt, you'll love this. If you loved The Road to El Dorado, you love this. If you've never seen any of those movies, just watch Sinbad. It's amazing. I'm so glad like somebody suggested this movie. I love it. I can't wait to watch it again. I'm so glad I got to see it. Shannon, what did you think of Sinbad?
Yeah, I really liked it. I was just looking up what year it came out and what it was competing against, because I'm trying to figure out why this movie didn't make as much money as it really deserves to make. It was competing against, in the summer of 2003, when I was 13 years old, Freaky Friday, Cheaper by the Dozen, and Holes. So that's some real competition there. So if you're wondering why this movie didn't have as much of a chance, it kind of seems like the animated movies that summer, or the live action movies that summer, drew in the audience, and these kids who were used to watching animated movies kind of were just getting old enough to where they wanted to see more teenage movies and stuff like that. So I think that might be part of the reason why it bombed. The other reason why it bombed, clearly some of this animation is not very good. Most of it is great, but when they have the giant creatures coming in, the sea monster, the owl, and the bird, I think at the end, those three creatures look really bad. The animation looks really bad. Even for 2003.
They look really good.
No, they look bad. They looked
the animation here was better than El Dorado and Prince of Egypt, in my opinion. It looked amazing in 4K.
The 3D birds that were flying around were clearly like not up to par. If you compare this to Shrek, which came out in 2001 by the same company, I don't know what happened. Like the integration between hand-drawn and 3D did not work out well. That being said, I really enjoyed the movie. George, you look like you're going to say something. Do you want to jump in, George?
Yeah. So what I was going to say is that the one thing I noticed is that on this particular movie, they ended up using on certain things, they actually used textures. All right.
Yeah.
So if you notice on some of the things, instead of actually like drawing out the entire cartoon, they were using a texture for it. So like if you look at like the deck of the ship that has a texture, like the that great big fish that came out of the water.
Yeah.
That they ended up pitching a ride on. That has a texture. Like some of the different things like that. And maybe that's part of the reason why it might not have meshed all that well, was because they were using like a combination of 2D, 3D sort of in that, simply because they were using texturing in it.
Yeah.
So a funny story, my TV, and if you guys ever upgrade, let me know, because I can get you the right TV. My TV is Dolby Vision, Dolby Ready. So what Dolby does is it takes the picture of what the intent of the directors and the makers of that movie is and makes it exactly like the way the director intended it to be.
So like, they remastered the movie when you saw it?
Yeah, so when I bought a TV, no joke, when I bought this TV, it was $4,000. I think it's dropped to, I think, 2000 now, but it's still pretty freaking expensive. Because it's a Dolby Vision. Like when we go to the Dolby Theater, like when we watch Infinity War, the quality is so above anything. Like it's just like insane. And I'm not even still using full blown power on that TV. That TV can do full 100% Dolby Vision. And I bought this TV like 4 years ago. It took like this year to finally come out with Dolby Ready like movies for my TV to actually, I'm like, oh, so this is what my TV is supposed to do. My TV was so advanced, it took 3 years later for me to watch it in Dolby HDR 4K, as crazy as that sounds. So what my TV does is it takes the intent of the movie. So every time you guys talk about this, I'm like, it looks great on my TV. But then I realized my TV switches.
It was terrible on mine.
Yeah, like my TV switches over to pure Dolby Vision. That's why they call it Dolby Vision. Because the vision you're seeing of the movie is the intent of every maker and director of that movie and what he wanted the movie to look like. So when you're watching it, so the colors, the darkness, how dark or light it gets, how much less or bright colors there's more textures, there's less textures, cannot be touched because Dolby Vision only plays the intent of the director and the makers of that movie. That's why Dolby Vision is so powerful, is because you're watching a movie that you can't play with. You can turn it off, of course. I mean, I could turn off Dolby Vision and watch it in regular, but again, I'm watching a movie with my version of what a movie should be, not what the director intended. So I'm not seeing things you're seeing, as weird as that sounds.
So I don't know if they did like a remastered Blu-ray version or something.
They did a remastered.
Okay, so I was not watching that version. I was not watching the remastered. I was not watching that, yeah.
I could you know, when that fish became, that island became a fish, and then the sun became the eyeball or something, that, me and Stephanie were just like, because it looks so freaking cool on our TV. I was like, holy crap, that looks amazing. And the mermaid scene, how the water just kind of like goes through the boat.
That was my favorite scene in this whole movie. Are we doing spoilers for this movie yet? It's been out for 25 years.
Let's do spoilers. Go see it. We love this movie.
Yeah, go see it.
Shannon didn't see it, and Georgia didn't see it.
Everybody should see it.
Wow. This movie's so great, even without the 3D textures. Yeah.
But,
watch
yeah,
it.
Yeah. Yeah. Another
watch
thing
it
is,
with your kids.
I watched this from Vudu with 1080p. So, like, I don't know if that has anything to do with it or not, but it seemed, I mean, it was, like, everything seemed all right. Like, it seemed like the previous times I had seen it. But, yeah, I don't know.
So, what are you watching movies on, Shannon?
Just my laptop, which is a newer laptop.
Okay, so you're watching on a very tiny screen and interesting. Okay.
I've been watching on my 4K Ultra HD TV, but it's, since it was 1080p, it's like it didn't have.
Oh, you have 4K Ultra HD. Yeah, like I bumped it. So my 4K Ultra bumps it to Dolby Vision 4K HDR, even if it's in 1080p. Can your TV do that? Because mine has that setting.
I don't
setting.
Think mine can.
Because mine's called the HDR Plus setting, which makes 1080p to.
I think mine is 4K. Just HDR.
So, getting into spoilers now.
It's been out. I don't.
It's really been out for like 30 years. So let's get the.
I mean, everything in this movie aside coming like a mile away. Like there was nothing in this movie that I didn't predict.
Yeah.
Like, oh, he likes the girl. He liked her. That's why he left the Navy and his friend. Obvious. It was obvious when she walked in. He was just like, I'm out. Like, let's go, guys. I was like, oh, he's in love with her. Cool. Got that. And then I was like, oh, like when the goddess in the beginning of the movie is like, I goddess always makes a promise, and she does the X thing. And I'm like, wow, did you just shoot yourself in the foot? That's the stupidest thing you could do. And she did it twice. I was like, are you kidding me? Like you're asking for him to like basically rip you off. And then he rips you off. It's like you literally walked into this on your own as a goddess. You're like the stupidest god I know. So like anybody could see that a mile away that was a bad idea. Probably shouldn't do that. Especially when it's somebody named Sinbad, the legend of the seven seas. Like his name is known as much as Jack Sparrow or like some famous pirate. Like out of all the people, get the guy who's like just barely talks in the ship. Why are you going to Sinbad? Just like, come on now. This is like the dumbest decision of all time. Like, like there's nothing in this movie that was not predictable, but it was still really good at the same time.
Yeah, it was predictable, but at the same time, it has everything in it that anyone could ever ask for in a movie. It's got mermaids, it's got pirates, it's got adventure, it's got intrigue, it has goddesses and plot twists, and it's got everything. Like, it's got all the cool stuff you want to see on a screen. So I'm really surprised that it didn't do better in theaters. And I don't know why. I think the only reason it didn't do better in theaters is that the 3D animation or like Shrek came out 2 years earlier. So like the big hand drawn, like the 3D animation was becoming really popular at that time.
And that's my biggest issue with movies today, is because that push drove out, I mean, like The Princess and the Frog, the last great Disney classic, that bombed. DreamWorks, yeah. Sinbad bombed, and so many other 2D films were just bombing. And all the audience, which I think is just so stupid.
Prince of Egypt bombed.
No, Prince of Egypt didn't bomb.
I think it did.
No, Prince of Egypt made double its money, and El Dorado made 100 plus million, so it succeeded. Only one to bomb is Sinbad. But because everybody wanted Pixar, everybody wanted, like, Shrek, nobody wanted to see 2D.
Yeah.
The audiences were that stupid. They were so excited about 3D, they pushed away 2D. That's why I'm so glad. Like, when I saw Weathering With You, it made me so happy.
Oh, I loved Weathering With You. It was so
because
good.
Because 2D animation is good still.
Yeah, it's so good.
Like, Your Name, Weathering With You, so many classic, like, Japanese animes, like, Hayao Miyazaki films that are just so, only could be made. They could not be made in 3D. You can only make them in 2D. And I think 2D animation, there has to be, I think it was the last Disney movie they did. They made Winnie the Pooh. Like the live action Winnie the Pooh, it also bombed. But that was the last movie to come out by Disney after Princess and the Frog. And the 2D animation guy actually quit after he made Winnie the Pooh. Because Disney was like, well, it bombed. You got to make it in 3D. And he was like, no. Like, I'm in love with 2D. I like hand-drawn animation. I don't care about computers. You can do 3D like you did in Sinbad, where it's like some 3D in the background, like you guys were talking about, because people like 3D, I guess. But it was just like, there's, you know, it's not, there are movies that are good, like Pixar is, like, I wouldn't want to see Pixar in 3D, but I also wouldn't want to see a Hayao Miyazaki or a film like this and Prince of Egypt in 3D. That would look so terrible. There's no reason for it. They need to have a distinction. Good Lord, like, we need more 2D animation films. 2D animation is great.
Speaking of adventure films such as this, Atlantis was actually another one that
was that 2003? Let me look that up.
Shannon with the cell phone Google.
I'm looking it up. I want to see.
It's 2004?
It was 2001.
2001?
2001 it came out.
Wow.
Yeah.
So this came out 2 years after. It did remind me a lot of Atlantis and Emperor's New Groove. Like, El Dorado, Stephanie made this comment, and I actually agree with her. She said El Dorado is like the DreamWorks ripoff of Emperor's New Groove.
Yeah.
And this is a Disney ripoff of Atlantis. And I was like, yes, but it's still really good, even though there's similarities.
I liked this better than Atlantis.
No, that is blasphemy. No, just kidding.
DreamWorks. And Disney for years were
Ants,
rivaling each other. So when Jeffrey Katzenberg and a couple of his friends left the Disney company to go start DreamWorks, they took with them all the plans for the next 10 years of movies that Disney was going to animate, and they ripped all of them off. And some of them they did better, and some of them they didn't do as well. But like, yep, they ripped off Emperor's New Groove. They ripped off Bug's Life with ants. They ripped off a ton of movies, and it was like the war of the studios. And it's so awesome because now we get two options for all of these different movies, and I like seeing what different creative people come up with.
Do you have Disney Plus, Shannon?
Yeah.
You do? You gotta watch that documentary. They talk about that. That whole documentary is about
There's many documentaries about it.
Imagine something.
There's a really great mini documentary on YouTube. It's called The Rise of the Eyebrow that I would highly recommend.
No, it's Disney Plus released it. It's called, I'll Google it later, but it's about all of that. Like how, when Walt Disney wanted Katzenberg or whoever that guy you're mentioning, they wanted him to be the head. And he was like, they were crushed when he decided to leave Disney and start DreamWorks Studios. Like,
Jeffrey Katzenberg.
Yeah, like when he left, people still hold that grudge at Disney still. It destroyed Disney for a good 10 years, and they couldn't recover from it until until I think Frozen. Frozen. It was like a whole period where Disney was just making, they had no idea, no one leading the ship. It wasn't until recently, like less than a decade. When did Frozen come out? 2013? So we're only talking 7 years.
Yeah.
And like, we're talking from 1999 or whenever Princess of Frog was. I think that was 1999 or 2000. All the way to 2013, Disney just made terrible movies over and over until Frozen, and they got their stuff. Pixar was still killing it, but Disney was just like a laughingstock for a good 13 years, I would say. And I thought that was really fascinating to watch because Disney Plus has that documentary. So I learned a lot. You should definitely watch it if you have Disney Plus.
Yeah, it talks about send the entire me the name. I would love to. I find it fascinating. Also, go back and watch Shrek, which was DreamWorks, one of their first movies that they made after they left Disney. All of Shrek is nothing but making fun of Disney and just mocking Disney. And Lord Farquaad is Mike Eisenberg or Bob Iger or any of those the big Disney guys.
To be fair, everybody hates Michael Eisenberg. He was terrible as CEO.
He's Lord Farquaad.
That makes sense.
But he was terrible. Some of you may die, but that is a sacrifice I am willing to make.
No, but he made terrible decisions at Disney. He almost sold Pixar out of all the things you could have done. Like, he almost sold Pixar.
And that's the worst decision you could ever make.
That's why I think Bob Iger has, like, literally saved Disney. They bought Star Wars. They bought Marvel. They kept Pixar. They brought Pixar and said, you're now in charge of Disney animation. And look what we got. Zootopia, Moana, Frozen, Big Hero 6.
Wreck-It Ralph.
What else am I forgetting? Wreck-It Ralph? Like, when Pixar, like, was given permission to animate for Disney, like, the movies that they came and started making, I'm like, why would you have not done this back in 2000? You would have saved
them. Yeah.
You made 13 years of just, like, what was that movie with them? Chicken Little? God, what a terrible film.
Oh, terrible movie. Terrible
Meet the Robinsons, which I liked, but it definitely wasn't
good. Yeah.
I like the ending. That
it was fine. It was okay.
It was just so adorable and very emotional. And but besides that, majority of those movies were just so, so bad.
I can't even name them. That's how bad they were.
Oh, I can. Because they named them in the documentary. Chicken Little. You had somebody else talk for a minute. I'm gonna Google this.
Treasure Planet and
I love Atlantis. Treasure Planet. Don't you dare say anything bad.
I love Treasure Planet too.
Treasure Planet is being made into a remake, and I am freaking out.
That is so awesome.
That movie's going to have a huge resurgence.
The movie bombed so badly.
Well, that's what I meant, yeah.
And it doesn't make any sense because Treasure Planet was out of this world, no pun intended. Amazing. And that captain, oh my God, the captain lady and the flying ship of like, oh, Treasure Planet was like epic Disney, and I can't believe nobody saw it. I don't understand how that movie could have bombed. It doesn't make any sense. The director was he did Black Cauldron, and he directed another movie, and Disney was basically like, if you make Black Cauldron and you play ball with us, we'll let you make this Treasure Island guy. Literally, it was like him just saying like, okay, fine, I'll make these movies so you can let me make Treasure Island. Or Treasure Island into Treasure Planet. The documentary, you really should watch it. I learned so much about Disney.
I will watch it. It sounds great. I saw Treasure Planet in theaters when I was a kid.
Oh, yeah? You guys keep talking. I got to find this. Wait, are you guys still there? Hello?
Yeah.
So if you go back and watch Shrek, this is one of my favorite things in the world. Go back and watch Shrek. Lord Farquaad is supposed to be Michael Eisenberg. And Shrek goes up to Donkey and they go and they see Lord Farquaad's huge castle. Okay, just like in Disney World, there's a huge castle. And Shrek goes, oh, you think maybe he's compensating for something?
And Donkey's like, huh?
Like, what? And as a kid, that joke just goes over your head. But as an adult, you're like, ah, that's hilarious. That's so funny. There's so many good digs at Disney in that movie if you go back and watch it as an adult. So funny.
Okay, so check this out. The end of the era. Can you guys hear me? Just out of curiosity, because I don't have the screen up.
Yep.
You guys? Oh, okay. Yep. Okay. So the end of the era started with Emperor's New Groove, which came out in 2000, and then 2001 was Atlantis, The Lost Empire. After that, we had Return to Neverland, which I've never even heard of, but that bombed. Lilo and Stitch also bombed. Spirited Away bombed. Spirited Away didn't bomb. It was Studio Ghibli. I don't know why it's because Disney
bought it. Yeah, Disney bought it later, but it wasn't Disney when it came out.
Right. So then they had Treasure Planet, Jungle Book 2, Piglet's Big Movie, Brother Bear, Teacher's Pet, Home on the Range, Pooh's Huffaloomp Movie 2005, Valiant, I don't know what that is. Chicken Little. Apparently they made Bambi 2 in 2006. What the hell? The Wild, never even heard of it. Meet the Robinsons 2007. Enchanted 2007, but that's not it's kind of animated.
I gotta cut in. The Wild was what Madagascar ripped off. The Wild is exactly like Madagascar. It's actually very funny, but it's got like a lion, a hippo, and a zebra and a monkey that go on an adventure because they escape from a zoo. And Madagascar ripped them off.
Okay, so then it's Enchanted, but that's not really animated. It's half some animated. I don't even know how to describe it. It's sort of animated. And the chick from Frozen is in it too, isn't she? I forgot her name. Who plays Elsa? The actress. She was in Enchanted.
Oh yeah, you're right. Idina Menzel.
She was in Enchanted. Then you had Tinkerbell in 2008. You had Bolt. I loved Bolt, by the way. So no problem there. Good Lord, how many Tinkerbell and the Lost Treasure? Apparently that came out in 2009. A Christmas Carol in 2009. The Princess and the Frog was 2009. I thought Princess and the Frog was like early 2000. What the crap? Okay. Tales from the Earthsea, never heard of it. And then the Renaissance started. 2010, Tangled entered the finally like arena. Classic arena. And then you had like what, Frozen and Zootopia and Big Hero
Frozen, 6 and Zootopia, Wreck-It Ralph, Big Hero 6, boom, 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 boom. Then they bought Star Wars, Marvel, all this stuff.
I like read half of those movies, like Bolt, Home on the Range. Like I don't even know what those movies are. I remember seeing Bolt for some reason. I remember it's a dog movie and a hamster and a ball. And that's
starring
all I remember.
Miley Cyrus.
Oh, that makes it sound terrible. Oh, wait, really?
Yeah, Miley Cyrus played the little girl in that.
Really? Hair just like going all over the place? Sorry. I don't know why it's doing that. I need a haircut probably, that's why. George, are you still with us?
Yeah. I'm still here.
All right, so we're going to move on. That's enough Disney history. Go see Sinbad, Legend of the Seven Seas, and experience the trilogy of these directors who did Prince of Egypt, El Dorado. I gotta see what else they've done. They must have done something else.
They did Shrek.
I've never even heard of Spirit.
Stallion of the Cinema.
Yeah, I saw the Spirit. It's not that amazing. It's all right.
I like that movie. I didn't know that was a DreamWorks. That movie was so good.
That was one of DreamWorks' first movies, yeah.
It's a good movie. I just didn't know. By the way, I hated Brother Bear. Oh my God, it was that movie.
Never saw it. My sister went and saw it when she was a kid, and I was like, I'm not going to watch it.
Kelly or Molly?
Kelly. She loved animals. She posts
pictures of animals.
Yeah, she has like a cat, a dog, a raccoon, a horse, and a duck, and a chicken right now.
She's starting a farm, it looks like, basically, with animals. Or a zoo.
She's a vet tech. She's got all kinds of weird animals.
Tell Kelly not to become Carol Baskin. She's not going to become Carol Baskin. Sorry, Kelly. That was a joke. If you ever somehow watch this, I'm not being serious. You're awesome. Go save the animals. You rock. All right, we're going to move on.